Welcome back to another .NET MAUI Beginner Series video. I'm James Montemagno, a product manager on the developer community team here at Microsoft, and we're continuing our journey learning .NET MAUI to build beautiful native cross-platform desktop and mobile applications. Now, so far we've built out an application with XAML, an XML-based markup for user interface. We've then extended it with MVVM and data binding to make our application responsive. Now what we want to do is something very common built into every single application, which is navigation. That's right, navigating from page A to page B. And additionally, what's great is that we can pass data between our pages too. Now, built into .NET MAUI are several ways of doing navigation. Specifically, we're going to take a look at URI shell-based navigation. I talked about shell in an earlier video, giving our structure to our application. But what's great about shell is that it not only includes a built-in dependency service to do constructor injection and dependency injection, but it also enables us to do a URI-based navigation, a URI, similar to a website. You go to /details and it will go to the details page. You can also send query parameters that can be simple data types or complex objects as well. It's very easy to do with .NET MAUI with just a few lines of code. So let's hop over to Visual Studio 2022 and get started.
So far, we've started to build our My Tasks application. And here we have full XAML user interface and data binding. So I can add different items inside of here, get nice animations. I can even swipe to delete. Now this is really great, but we want to also be able to maybe tap into an item and go to details. So what we're gonna do now is add navigation into our application. So let's go ahead and do that. The first thing here is that this is the same application that we've been building through this entire beginner series. So we have our main page, we have our image, our entry, our button, and our collection view here. And we've added a swipe view so we can add that swipe to delete. We also have a main view model, which is essentially the code behind for that page that's doing different observable properties that we can do data binding to. So that text property that we see there has a data binding to this text property right here on the entry. All right, let's add another page that we can navigate to. I'm going to go ahead in and I'm going to right click on the MAUI app 2 and say add new item. When I do that, I'll be brought to this screen that enables me to select different items. And there's even a subcategory specifically for .NET MAUI. So here we have different pages and views and resources. I'm going to select the content page XAML for .NET MAUI. And we're going to call this detail page. Now, this page is a very simple page that just says, welcome to .NET MAUI. There it is. Perfect. And there's, of course, no code behind. It just is very, very simple. Now, the other thing we're going to do is pair this up with a view model. So I'm going to come in and say add. I'm going to say new item. In here and under code, we're going to add a class. And we're going to say detail view model. I like to name my view models very similarly to the page. So detail page, detail view model. I've added a new class, so we're gonna add some nice C# 10 features in here like file scope namespaces. We're also gonna make this a public partial class. And we're gonna also inherit from our observable object. And that observable object is coming from our MVVM toolkit for .NET and MVVM. So that community toolkit gives us everything we need to start doing MVVM here, which is really great. All right, next up, what we need to do is we need to associate this detail view model with our page. So inside of our detail page.xaml code behind, what we're gonna do is we're gonna, in the constructor, say detail view model VM. Make sure we come in and bring in that namespace. And then we're gonna set the binding context here over to the VM. Perfect. Now, just like we did for our main page and our main view model, we're also gonna register those in our MAUI program. This is gonna register them with our dependency service, so when we navigate to them, it automatically will associate the detail page with the detail view model. Now, the difference here is that before we're adding singletons, but really every single time we navigate to a new page, we wanted to create a new page. So we're gonna change this to add transient. Singleton, you can kind of think of as a global where it creates one copy of it, and then it will go ahead and keep that in memory. else, a transient will be created and then destroyed, and a new one will be created every single time. So this is what we want to have happen every time we navigate. All right. So now what we're going to do at this point is register the detail page with the routing system of .NET MAUI shell. So here inside of our app shell, which again, if you remember in here, has shell content of the main page has a route of main page, which is very convenient. I like to name my routes the same as the name page here. We're going to come in and register this page in the code behind. Since it's not part of the shell, right? If I had tabs or I had flyout, it would be part of it. But here we just want to navigate to it. So let's go ahead and do that. What we're going to do now is we're going to say routing dot register route. And this is going to take in two things. First is the route itself. So I could say detail page and give it the detail page. It could be detail. It could be whatever I want the string to be. I like to use the name of property a lot because in C#, if we refactor, it will also then cascade down. And then we're going to associate with a type. So we're going to say type of detail page. There we go. This is really nice. So this gives me a string of detail page to navigate to and a type of detail page to navigate to as well. Perfect. All right, now let's do some navigation before we actually pass some data across. So here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna come into our main page, and there's several ways that we can add navigation when we click on an item in the collection view. Here we can say selected, and we can see that there's a selection changed event and a selection mode. So that is one way if we wanna register an event with a collection view, which is an option. Now, I'm actually going to say selection mode is none here because we don't want to use the built-in selection mode because we're actually just doing navigation. I'm not actually selecting anything. I'm more like tapping on an item. So what I want to do here is on the frame itself, which is housing this label, is I want to add a tap gesture recognizer. This is another powerful feature, is that there's tons of built-in gesture recognizers, and one specifically that we'll use is the tap, but there's also a swipe, a pinch, a pan, a drop, a drag. But here we're going to use a tap gesture recognizer. Now inside of here, you can assign a tapped event or specifically a command, which is very, very nice, similar to our swipe view above. You can also say the number of taps required. So if you had something you needed to tap 10 times, you could do that as well. So I'm going to go ahead and simplify this here, and I'm just going to go ahead and copy and paste the command from our swipe to delete, and then we're going to change it. So what we saw earlier is that we needed to get access and say, please do some data binding up the stack to our main view model. And here, what we're gonna do is instead of going to the delete command, let's go ahead and say the tap command, for example. And here, what we're gonna do is pass in a parameter of the string that was bound to the label here. So now in our main view model, we need to go ahead and add that command. So we have that delete command there. Let's go ahead and add another async task this time of tap, pass in string of s, there we go. And now what we're gonna do is go ahead and make this an I command. That again is gonna do some source generation for us, so it generates the tap command for us. And now what we're gonna do is we're gonna go ahead and do some navigation. So here I'm gonna say await, and again we're doing this async task because it's awaiting actually doing the navigation. And this is going to use the shell navigation. So shell.current.goToAsync. Now, what I like about this is that I can just pass it the detail page or that route identifier that I defined in my app shell right here. I can also pass it the string directly, which is also very, very nice. So if I wanted to, I could come in back into my main view model here and replace this hard-coded string with the name of detail page. And now this is going to tell the shell to go to that detail page directly, which is pretty awesome. So let's go ahead and compile this up and start actually tapping on an item and then doing navigation to that detail page. And again, this is up to you if you want to reference the detail page there or if you want it to be a string or have some association, totally up to you and your application architecture. So now let's give this a second to compile up the application and deploy. All right, our application is launching here, and let's go ahead and add an item into our list. So again, apples, I'm gonna go ahead and add that, and now I'm gonna do a tap event. And boom, just like that, we've navigated to a new page, and we can see welcome to .NET MAUI. Now, the other thing I'm able to do is, of course, modify that XAML. So if I wanna say font size of 25, for example, hit save. Sure enough, that's going to update there. We could also add, a little bit of padding here of, let's say, 20. Now we get a little padding there. Perfect. Now, that's pretty great that we just did some navigation, but it sure would be great to pass the actual detail page information. So, for example, the item I selected. And additionally, maybe add a button here that says go back, right? That'd be pretty nice. So let's go ahead and do that next. So here's what we're going to do is we're going to stop debugging. We're going to go into our main view model again. And now what we're going to do is we're going to pass it information. And there's two ways of doing that. The first way is to add it as a query property. And this is very similar to a URL. So for example, I can go ahead and do some string interpolation here. So here we'll do some detail page. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to say question mark. And then I'm going to say text equals. That is going to be my query identifier. So that's the ID there. And then I can pass in S, for example, which is the string that was tapped here to go ahead and pass that along. So this is really important because this enables me to send simple data types like strings and integers across. But what if you had a complex data type like a person or a monkey or a car or some other data object? What's great is that you can pass not only through the query property here, but you can also pass in a new dictionary of object, of string object, which is your key values. So for example, here, it just goes ahead and fills it in. I could, for example, say, well, it's the detail page, an S, for example, or I could pass in, you know, a new object of something, whatever it is inside of here. And you can pass that information across. So if you have complex data types, it works exactly the same as simple data types, but you have this big bucket dictionary here, which is really, really cool. And I'll link to documentation in the show notes on exactly how to do that as well. But let's just go ahead and pass a simple data property across of the string. So how are we going to get that string into our detail view model? Well, we can add a query property in one of two places. We can do it in our detail page, which would be okay if we didn't have any MVVM in any view models, but we can also add it directly into our view model itself. So on the top of this, we're going to add a query property. So this is really cool. And the query property takes in a name, which is going to be the name of the property inside of the detail view model to bind to. So we'll say text, that's what we're going to name it. And the query property ID of text as well. So again, this property here that's passed in is going to be the same exact one that we registered here. So if this was ID, for example, then you change this to ID, just like that. I like to name them the same. That is just me. It makes it simpler for me to remember. But now we need to create this text property, and we're going to create one that we're going to do some data binding to. So I'm just going to say string text, and I'm going to mark that as an observable property. And again, the reason that this data binding to text will work is because if we go into our dependencies and look at our analyzers for our community toolkit that we brought in, that went ahead and it generated those properties for us automatically. So there's the text and it does all the changing for us, which is really nice. It keeps our code really simple. And that's why I absolutely love the .NET Community Toolkit for MVVM. Now let's add one more thing, is which maybe a way to navigate back. So I'm gonna do another async task here and say go back. There we go. And now what I'm gonna do is await on shell.current.goToAsync. Now to go backwards, I don't need to reference the main page because that would actually push a page onto the stack. I want to navigate back, and similar to how you would navigate around the file system, I'm going to use dot dot. And that is how I'm going to navigate backwards. You can also do additional navigation at any time by adding a forward slash. So that would navigate back and then to another page. So if I had detail or I had a monkey page, for example, that would navigate to that page. And you could do that a bunch. For example, go up two pages and then also pass parameters back and forth. So that's really, really nice. Now what we're going to do is also mark this as an I command because that is going to go ahead and turn it into a command for me. And it'll be called go back command. That'll be automatically source generated. So now what I'm going to do is go one more time into my detail page. And instead of doing welcome to Maui, we're going to do some data binding. We also need to do our association to our data type, so that way it's compiled and bound. So I'm going to say a new XML and S namespace of view model. And here I'm just going to type in view model. It's going to find that it's in this namespace. So we're kind of creating a XAML namespace. I'm going to say X data type, and that'll be a view model to the detail view model. And now what I'm able to do is do a binding here to the text property. There it is. Now let's also create a button here and say text go back. And then what I'm going to do is register the command to the binding of go back command, just like that. Perfect. Now let's go ahead and do some data binding again, all set up, and see our navigation. What we want to see is whatever item I tap on, it should go ahead and navigate to that page and then automatically set the text property when I navigate. So now we have our application up and running. I'm going to say apples, add it there. I'm going to add oranges as well. When I tap on one, sure enough, we have apples and a go back command that navigates backwards. Oranges, go back. Apples, go back. We just implemented navigation to and from pages, back navigation, and the ability to pass query parameters or full objects using the built-in navigation system of .NET MAUI.
And there you have it. You've just done some navigation in your .NET MAUI application. We've passed data from page A to page B, and we figured out how to navigate back as well. Now, what we're going to do next in the .NET MAUI Beginner Series is take a look at how we can integrate native platform APIs. Now, .NET MAUI gives you them inside of C#, but also gives you an abstraction over common platform features, such as sensors, geolocation, and connectivity. So stay tuned to the next video in the .NET MAUI Beginner Series to learn more.